Okay, guys, welcome to this track. Thank you for coming today to see this journey that we have during the last year, let's say. And we are going to talk about how we migrate the solution we have to run and exploit our Spark jobs or algorithms in the solution that we implemented. In the first step, we use Amazon Web Services tools. And now we have a new solution using open source Kubernetes portable solutions. But let's start introducing ourselves.
Hi, I'm Ramiro Álvarez, Stack Platform Engineer at Empathy.co. And well, I'm mainly interested in infrastructure, observability, and performance. And yes, this is me after KubeCon Europe 3 weeks ago. Therefore, please stay safe, guys. Don't be like me and stay safe in the Berlin buzzwords. And yeah, we are hiring too. Therefore, you can go to our website and find the details there.
So, good afternoon. I'm Daniel Hernandez. I work as a data engineer in the data team. And what we do in the data team is collecting all events provided from the websites or from our customers in order to provide analytics to the merchandisers and improve the final user experience. We wanted to remark, and if you already attended our colleagues' talks about privacy and relevancy, that we don't store any personal data providing from the users, but we only aggregate them in order to improve the average user experience.
Okay, and this is me. It's a bit difficult nowadays to explain what I do, but let's say that I try to understand the customers and market needs to translate it or help my colleagues to translate it to real work, evolution in the systems, new features. And I'm super boring in social media, so let's move on. Okay, we are going to talk a lot in this talk about Spark jobs, how we escalate solutions, what are these algorithms or these jobs. But let's start with a bit of context. We, most of us here, we do search. We have some talks today, so you can imagine the type of data that we collect in Empathy. As Danny said, we collect all the information without personal information, location information, nothing related with the user. The talk this morning gave more details, but yeah. Happy to hear your opinions in our discussions about the topic in social media. We collect all these events that we have in the shopper experience in our search journey, and oversimplifying a bit the solution, we push all this data in a data lake. So in Empathy, we realized some years ago that we need to exploit this data, obviously, and we have several blocks of how we use the data. We can use it for reports, for visualizations, and we have another big group that we are going to see a live demo today about one of these algorithms of jobs, that is the search intelligence group. In this group, we mainly create features based on the wisdom of the crowd to help the user in the interface to feel more guidance. And as you can see in the slide, we use Spark to create these algorithms. But why? It's a good question. So I want to do here like this typical raise your hand to see more or less. I don't know how many of you work with Spark in your companies. Okay, nice. I know some of these hands. Okay. For you, probably this is not interesting and you are going to criticize me because it's an oversimplification, probably. But let's say that we have this scenario. As I mentioned, we have a data lake with some data. We have some algorithms that we have implemented in Spark. These algorithms can be like something super complicated or something super simple. For that, Spark provides us different libraries like SQL libraries, ML libraries, all these super fancy words that I'm super difficult for me to pronounce as a Spaniard. But let's say that we can create something super simple like extract from the data, from our data. What is the most clicked product, let's say? Obviously, this is a job or an algorithm that runs and finish and saves some results in some place, database, index. So we don't need a server running 24/7. To execute these jobs. But why Spark help us here? This obviously, even if it's a simple operation, takes some computation time. And Spark help us here, since we can split this computational time in different executor nodes and join the results at the end. So let's say that our entry data is 10 gigas, so every one of these executors, each one of these executors will take a portion of this data, so the computation time is reduced. In fancy worlds, we can work with large data sets with low computational times. This also have a good thing, that is that we can escalate the solution, so if we have more entry data, more input data, we can add more, let's say, executors to the solution, and we can execute the solution with the same computational time, more or less. Okay, so we have some algorithms, we have a cool technology that allows us to run these algorithms and generate these results super fast. But we are going to take a look at the first solution that we implement to run these jobs using Amazon Web Services tools.
So this is about the former solution that... Can you hear me? Yes. Okay. Sorry. This is about the previous solution that we were using running on Amazon EMR that we were using before moving to Kubernetes. We were using native technologies on Amazon Web Service like CloudWatch to schedule the different jobs that we run on a daily basis. Este functions that has contain all the logics to orchestrate the complete workflow from running the cluster, running the jobs. A lambda function that we use is to check the cluster status during the process and also running the Spark jobs. We use the IP gateway to access all this infrastructure from the outside, and if we run some job on demand, for instance. And finally, we use S3 to store the final results of the Spark jobs that we run in. We had in-house monitoring and logging solutions that were some rudimentary, and we wanted to improve this with the new solution. In this slide, you will see the complete process that we used to run the job. We started uploading our artifact that contains the jobs to S3. And once we have that, we use CloudWatch with the scheduler expression to run the jobs on a daily basis or every 13 hours. We configure it using the cron expression, the specification of the job, and the input parameters that the job needs. And after that, all the logic that contains all the complexity is located at in the step functions. The step functions start with running a cluster on EMR. Here is when we waste most of the time that we needed, because the cluster lasts about 10 or 15 minutes to be up and running and provision instances. And after it is up and running, we can run a certain number of jobs that are present on the input configuration. It's a variable number. And for each job, we check its status, we handle jobs retries if they fail, and if one job succeeds, we concatenate the next one until the last one. When some job fails or other have succeeded, we terminate the cluster. In the bottom of the slide, you could see that there is a JSON expression with all the information that the stem function needs to handle all this orchestration, and has to store API responses from EMR, from the lambdas. So at the end, we end up with a very complex structure that we needed to simplify in order to make our lives easier. Now, talking about the problems that we can find on this solution. Next slide, please. Sorry, I skipped this slide. And this is how we can specify the different jobs that we wanted to run. We have the cron expression, the name of the job, and the main information that are the class that contains the logic from the Spark jobs and the different arguments. This jobs is what the step function takes and run it subsequently. And now, yes, talking about the problems of this solution, the first one is that using EMR is managed by AWS, so we don't have control on the version that is running on the cluster, and the dependencies that the cluster is including. So since we have a jar file that is not a container, we don't have an isolated environment, and the dependencies can come into conflict. Another problem is the autoscaling. EMR does not base the autoscaling on resource usage, but on pending on number of input tasks, pending task managers from Spark. So that's not a good autoscaling solution because it can take, as I said before, some minutes to have new instances up and running. And the other is the cost that it takes. It's the cost that you have to pay to run Spark jobs on Amazon is not only the cost associated to the type of machines that you are using inside the cluster, but also you have to pay an extra cost for running EMR jobs. About the monitoring and logging, we don't have good solutions here to make the cluster observable. For example, the Spark History Server, which allows you to monitor the different jobs that have run, dies when the cluster is terminated, so you don't have access to that information after the cluster is finished. And also, this was not a cloud agnostic solution. So if we wanted to portate this solution, for example, to another cloud like GCP, this was not possible. And last but not least, the step function that handles of this logic and orchestrates the job has a lot of complexity, as I mentioned before. Here you can see all the logic that the step function contained. You don't need to understand it right now because there is a lot of complexity here. But the main points are that you have to, the step function tries to run an on-spot cluster. If it fails, then it tries a cluster with on-demand machines. And after waiting for the cluster is up and running, we launched the different jobs that we wanted to concatenate. All the jobs have retries management, and after all the work succeeds or one of them fails, we have to terminate the cluster. So when, at the end, this kind of logic, the logic of this function was very hard to manage, and we wanted to move to the Kubernetes solution.
Well, you can see here that this is kind of a mess. But let me highlight something important, like in the things that didn't work for us in the solution, is that it's important the portability for us, because you have your environment. In AWS, you have your teams working in your algorithms, but you find in the market some opportunities to exploit this algorithm of these jobs in other environments. So it's something that we consider as really important to create the new solution that Ramiro is going to tell us.
So it looks like we had an elephant in the room. So as we were moving to Kubernetes, all our microservice architecture, we thought it would be nice to have our Spark application there too, because we can reduce the cognitive load of our developers and don't use a way to deploy the Spark application and another way to deploy our other microservices. Therefore, after a request for comment, some months later of work from multiple teams, we can give you what technologies we are using on our journey to Spark on Kubernetes. First of all, you know, Kubernetes, you need it to orchestrate all your microservices. Besides, we didn't want to distribute the Spark application using jars, as Danny commented before. We would like to handling in using distributed images and increasing the isolation using Docker. Besides, we love the GitOps approach. The developer experience is really nice. And the user interface love it. We were using Argo CD for all our microservices, therefore we embrace it too for the Spark applications. Although you can use vanilla Spark to deploy your Spark application on Kubernetes and create all your Kubernetes resources by yourself, we prefer to do things easy. Therefore, we deploy Spark Operator, that is a project started by Google and now open source, that allow you to create a custom resource definition to create and handle Spark application easily. As we would like to distribute the Kubernetes manifest through multiple clusters, we are using Helm to increase the agility to deploy them. Besides, when you are running a Spark application, sometimes you would like to concatenate jobs, deploy one job, another, create a complex graph. You know, you can use the vanilla job, the Kubernetes vanilla job definition, but when you are running a concatenate job, it's not enough. Therefore, we review Argo workflows. It accomplishes all our requirements. Therefore, it fits so nice with Argo CD. And for those who doesn't know, Argo is an incubating project from the Cloud Native Foundation and has a great support from the community. We are using a multiple ephemeral Spark application. Therefore, we don't want to have instances running or running every day. We don't want to have orphan resources or idle resources. We would like to, because we are wasting money, wasting resources, and increasing our carbon footprint. Therefore, we are using Cluster Autoscaler to, as soon as we deploy the Spark application, the instances can be provisioned. Therefore, we can have the right resources at the right time and save money. You know what happens when it happens. You need metrics, you need dashboards. Probably some of you know these icons. We are using Prometheus to save all our metrics, Push Gateway to send all the metrics from the Spark application to Prometheus, and Grafana to just explore and create some nice dashboards on it. But how everything works together? Let me explain with you with a little sample, and we can go ahead. First of all, we have Git to where all the code is located. And from there, we can go to push our Docker image and Helm chart to a image repository, in our case, Harbor, Bar, but you can use whatever repository image you want, like ECR, GCR, whatever, doesn't matter. The next one, you need a Kubernetes cluster. We have the Spark operator set in place, therefore you can create, you have the Kubernetes custom resource there, and you can create the Spark application easily. And you define the Spark application in code, and Argo CD is going to sync the changes on your code and deploy it to the cluster. It's going to reconcile the status again and again and again. And Argo workflows, as I commented before, you would like to concatenate jobs, create complex graphs. For us, this is a simple use case scenario. We are going to execute the job one, and after finish, we would like to execute the job two. In the first job, you are going, as you can see, there are a driver and multiple executors. We have the cluster autoscaler. Therefore, as soon as the executors are deploying, the cluster autoscaler is going to deploy new instances. Therefore, we are going to save money, save resources, because we are going to have the right resources at the right time. And after finish, we can go to the job two. You can see that is same logic than before. And all this, what has in common? The observability stack. We have the Prometheus metrics there. All our Spark application are sending the metrics to Prometheus using the push gateway, and we can have the dashboards on Grafana to explore, review the metrics, the performance, whatever. And now, I think that it's time for a demo, but first, let me take a selfie, guys.
Yeah, come on, make some noise. Let's make a video of the guys that are in the other tracks.
Say cheese! Thank you, guys.
Thank you, guys. Okay, Let's go for the demo. Let's take a look first to example that we have here. This is a demo client, demo showcase. And we want to play a bit with this. Let's say that I open. You can see here a lot of things that we commented on in other talks during today. But it's important to mention that some of these elements that you see in the interface are generated by these jobs running in Spark, running in the solution. And we are going to execute now one. But let's try play a bit with this to understand what we are going to do. You see that I have some suggestions here, and I can find for a search for a blue top, for example. Here I don't have more interaction elements in this query. Just I can filter, for example, if I can filter for a specific color like blue, I can do it, or a specific collection, whatever I want. But I don't have nothing to refine more my query, and this is something that we are going to do now. We are going to run a Spark job that will generate what we call related tags. Anna in the last talk explained it super good, but it's a feature that will generate tags attached to the query term that I'm doing. So if I search for top, in this case, blue can be a related tag of top. This feature will help us a lot to guide the user in the interface and to refine the query. So this is something super nice for the users to feel this guidance in the interface.
Oh yeah, I was sorry. Let me show them the code, Panizo. Yeah. You can see the, let me show you the code because, sorry. You can see in this snippet what we are doing, this a reality. As you can see, we can set your repository, your tag in the image location. Besides, you can set easily your Spark version, the path of your main application, the time to leave seconds. And besides, you know, you don't want to hardcode all your credentials on code. Therefore, you can set all the Hadoop configuration with the needs for your OIDC or your provider. And besides, we are working with a scheduled Spark application. Therefore, we would like to have an historical limit that allow us to check if Spark application failed during the time. But you are going to ask me, what? How can you create all these orchestrate jobs with Argo workflows or something like that?
So this is the way that we use to configure jobs on using Argo workflows. It's very similar to the way that we configure it using AWS CloudWatch. This is an example of a job that has two jobs that run subsequently. There are two workflows. One of them has one job, and the other has three jobs that run subsequently. You have the cron expression for every workflow, and that goes inside the Helm chart that we have deployed. So that's easy to configure. If we go to the interface of Argo workflows, we can see an example of one of these jobs that ran, for example, some hours ago. We have here five jobs that have been concatenated. We used to put it subsequently because some of them depend on the other, and we don't have the need to run it immediately. So we prefer to have a node pool with a small number of nodes and run them subsequently. But Argo workflows allows you to create any DAG, a cyclic graph, to run jobs in parallel if you want. We can run now one more job to see how it works. This usually takes about half an hour or 45 minutes. So in the middle time, you can check your Telegram message or sound.
You're worried, Harry? No, just joking. Why? Yeah, it's true that this takes 30 minutes to execute. So we're going to execute a smaller item without graphs. Let's believe us when this first job finishes, the second one is going to start and it will finish and it will work. We are awesome. But let's execute a specific job, the job that I say to you related with this related tags. We are going to run one of these jobs. Here in Argo, we can see that we have already set some templates to easily run these jobs. We can came here to this query signal jobs. That is the job that generate for us, is the name that we put for this job to generate these related tags. And here, if we click on submit, we can see that this super easy interface. I need to select the entry point. That is the template. Here you can see that I have my Docker image. I can put here a nice name for you. And we are going to see this working in real life with a demo in production. Yeah, we are crazy.
Yeah.
Okay, let me open a console. So if I move here to the production environment in one of our namespaces, you can see it good, right? Yeah, more or less. Okay. First, we are going to check the pods related with this job that we want to run. And we can see that we don't have nothing here. So nothing is running for Spark. We don't have servers running, nothing there. But I'm going to click here. I'm going to execute this job only for one of our demo customers. This is a parameter. Okay. Okay, I miss an S. Okay, I think it's going to work. Okay, now if we came back here, we see things, Kubernetes doing things. We have a driver. I'm going to reset this because when things started, it drives a bit crazy, but you can see here a clear picture. You can see that we have a driver and we have some executors. We can check also in the presentation in the meantime how this can be expressed in our charts. For example, here we have a driver, as you can see, with the memory and core limits and the number of executors that we use. In this case, is 4. You know that we can escalate this solution if we have more data coming in. So one cool thing that we can do is with this all this setup is that we can check the logs in real time where it's being executed. So if we do here, sorry, I have the mic.
Do you need a hand?
Logs minus F, and I copy here the path of the driver. I can see logs in real time. So this is what is happening in our job. It will take only probably like a minute and a half. We are taking into account, I don't know, 10 days of mock data. So it will do some things to discover these things. We have a nice article in our engineering blog about how we generate these things. So you can take a look. When this job finishes, it's going to finish the resources, as Ramiro explained. So everything is going to be super nice. So, okay, this is nice. We can check the logs in real time, but we want more granularity in the metrics as we explained with Prometheus and all these things.
Yes, one of the problems that we had with the EMR solution was the lack of observability. And here we can see the first improvement, that is the history server is up and running 24/7. In AWS, we have it only available during the cluster lifecycle. So you can inspect any of the jobs that have run, navigate into them, and try to find any issue that you can have with balancing tasks or so on. And the other improvement in observability was pushing custom metrics on our jobs. So we have some Grafana dashboards with information about the jobs that have run. For example, in the query signal job that we are running, you have the number of indexed documents that the jobs output, the duration of the jobs, or the resource usage during the jobs running. But how can we configure this in the Helm chart?
Yeah, this is pretty simple. There are some common friction points between the platform engineers thing and the developers to how to configure the alert manager, the Prometheus, all that stack. One of our goals from the platform engineer team is to provide a better developer experience and a faster feedback loop. Therefore, well, this is all the snippet configuration, but in the same Spark application definition in the Helm chart, all our developers can set their favorite Slack alert channel. Maybe some of them would like to have some labels and other ones others. And besides, they can deploy their favorite Grafana dashboards in their favorite namespace, as simple as it is. But I think that we have a demo still running, doesn't it?
Yeah, probably finished already, hopefully. Let's see. Yeah, okay, the application is finished, and you can see here in the resources that all the drivers and all these things were finishing, so if we check for the pods right now, probably they are completed and we don't have executors anymore. So yeah, this runs. But we are going to check the demo again, see if it works. So now if I search for a single term, I'm going to remove this filter, like for example, top, I'm going to see here, as you can see, the related tags that we just generate. So I can filter this information with a more guidance feature. Instead of using the filters, I can filter easily by terms that are trendy or the people is using most. Okay, but I think we have some takeaways.
Yeah, last minutes, don't worry. Yeah, we improve our time execution a lot. The improvement was mainly because the cluster autoscaling provides the instances faster than the usual AWS EMR solution. Besides, another important point is that our developers start to embrace this solution because they are using each day more jobs, more Spark applications. Another important point is the cost. You know, this is business. AWS EMR has a license fee. Well, AWS EKS has a license fee too. Anyway, we reduce a lot our cost of the Spark clusters. And besides, let me show you the summary all for this talk. We increase our portability deploying thanks to Kubernetes. We provide isolation images using Docker. And we can increase the agility of deploy the Spark application on multiple clusters using Helm chart in an easy and idiomatic way using the Spark operator and using a GitOps approach easy to understand for everyone thanks to Argo CD and using multiple how to orchestrate multiple jobs easily with Argo workflows. Besides, the cluster autoscaling provides us a faster feedback loop because it can provide instances faster. And everything with an awesome stack, observability stack, with so simple configuration, improving a lot the developer experience from our developers. I think that this is a lot. And now, Panizo, I think that could improve and summarize this talk.
Yeah, improve. I doubt it. But yeah, so we have a good solution. Ramiro already summarized all the good points, bad points that we have in the old solution versus new solution. But let me say to you my point of view. I developed some code in the data science team that we have and this solution. I need to say that it's amazing for developers. It's super friendly. We have also, as I mentioned in the middle of the talk, that is portable. So we don't care about to have another use case, another environment. We can just shoot our Kubernetes definitions there, and everything is going to run nicely. This is everything that we have for you. Remember to check our media, our engineering blog. We have some interesting things related with this and with more things there, and hope you enjoy.
Thank you very much, guys. So we still have some little time for questions. Is there any question in the audience? Yeah, we have a couple of them back there. I'll be right there.
First of all, thank you very much for your presentation. I have a question regarding, have you faced new challenges or new difficulties while moving away from EMR to Kubernetes? I mean, for example, one of my main concerns is that, first of all, you need to have people that have working experience using a cluster using Kubernetes. That means administration, security, networking, etc.
Yeah, thankfully, this is not from zero to 100%. And we have 2 years of experience with Kubernetes, but you know, it's easier to deploy some microservices, and the AWS EMR solution was depending on status and was an elephant in the room, as I commented before. It was a little bit more, you know. Therefore, in platform engineer, we have a couple of years of experience administrating clusters, and all our developers has a user experience on Kubernetes. Therefore, it was pretty easy to handle it.
Yeah, also, if you take a look to the old solution, you see all the pieces that we have there. So yeah, the complexity of running Kubernetes or managing all these things, new things, is big when you start with it. But when you take a look to the solution that we had, we did a trace of this solution right now, and we need to check why we use AP Gateway, why we use Lambda lately, because it was also super complex to understand all the pieces working together. And now I think it's much more easy to understand the overall thought. Yeah,
so again, congratulations on the talk. Two questions. One is, was Kubernetes adoption as a consequence of you having already some Kubernetes systems, or there was a pretext to adapt Kubernetes just to tackle this issue? And then the second question is, do you do any sort of capacity planning for Spark jobs, for example, to have some minimum executor values or maximum executor values, or just hope for the Kubernetes to scale?
Great question. Thank you. The Spark was like, the teams has a very huge cognitive load working with AWS EMR. Therefore, we were like, OK, we have to think about a solution to that. We start thinking and analyzing and reviewing Spark Operator or some other approaches, like do it yourself. We have the Kubernetes microservices, a lot of microservices there, but a simple one with deployments on some stateful set, but you know, not all the orchestration from the Spark application. Therefore, the Kubernetes reach first the company than Spark on Kubernetes. And the second question, a very good question, we have some dedicated node pools to has all our Spark application. As you could see in the slides, I think that is enough. You can see a driver and some executors. As we would like to have a faster provision, the driver we decide to set on an on-demand node pool, and the executors are on spot instances. Therefore, you can the node pool is going to autoscale from zero to whatever, and downscale after the job finish. It's pretty simple. The cluster autoscaler works pretty fine, and the Spark operator cover all our requirements, all our visibility, because you know you have a Spark operator, but how are you going to be sure that the Spark operator is working? Because if it's not working, you are.
That's it. Brilliant. Thank you.
Thank you.
Great. Then let's thank the speakers again for the awesome talk.
Thank you.